to wondering how I knew I'll choke fans to make me blue with some other guy you knew before. Between the two of us guys, you know I love you more. It took me by surprise, I must say, when I found out yesterday. Don't you know that I heard it through the grapevine, 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 grapevine. I
just another Romeo, the shoe you passed by in the store window. But soon as I got home, I wish I bought you instead. I got it bad, I'll take the black. takes in navy and red. No other man has ever, ever had quite this effect. I sleep alone, cause there's no room in my bed for any other lover. With no gun to my head, your kisses hold me hostage, and I don't wanna stop it.
Hope you all are enjoying the music. We got another break for you. We got some music for you.
This camera phone, and we can live like the camera's on. No script though. These boys claiming they ball, got no grip though. My flow switch mode, it's so schizo. So I'm the one that your girl blow kiss for. You gotta love me, cold world, no snuggie. Baddest girls hug me, my mind on you though. You hoping I'm the one, but I already knew though. It ain't no secret that I get around. True, but girl, you make me wanna settle down with you. Get a crib with a view, lay up in the bed, make a kid, maybe two. All my ex-girlfriends gon' have to get a clue, cause the rumors that you heard about is true.
I said I only wanna give it to you, and I want you more than the new pair of shoes. I only wanna give it to you, and I'll show you how did you feel like I do.
Yep, we are back.
All right.
Thank you. That was a real short break. I wish we had more time, but I want to keep things on schedule and, you know, get started with our next round of talks. So first, we'll start with another sponsored talk. Like to welcome Intel. Intel also joined the Presto Foundation recently. And from Intel, I have a talk from William Wirtz. He is going to be talking about Intel and Presto better together. So let's get that talk going.
Everyone, my name is Will Wirtz, and I'm here on behalf of Intel. We are very excited to be at our second Presto event. We attended the initial Presto Con, but we're here back again for more with Presto Con Day. We think this is really important way for us to communicate and connect with the community, which is why we're back and we're here to pick up the conversation where my fellow colleague Fall Diabati left off after he espoused Intel's prevalence in the open source community. And now we're here to talk a little bit more about that, as well as the inroads that we've made with Presto itself and our key partner, HANA. Open source, again, has been critical to Intel's strategy, dating back to even the 1990s with the original Linux optimizations and kind of elevating it to the point where it has become such an important operating system today and really a key foundation for which open source software is able to run and be enabled. There's many different facets here, whether that's our investment in the end customers, whether that's creating new key technologies to make developers' lives easier and to enable more enterprise software at scale. It's been a long journey, but we're very happy that we've been able to be a part of it. There's really two parts to this journey. The first part is the upstream development and bringing the software to fruition. And we've kind of invested in many different parts of this, and had a very open conversation and discourse with key developers and solution architects to make sure that our software stack, our hardware portfolio, and a lot of our adjacent products really meet their needs rather than do it the other way around. We want the feedback. We want that integration, as a deep hardware software integration is really the best way to ensure the best TCO and performance out of all of these different solutions. And kind of on the downstream side, this is where we actually see much of this work and this technical enablement come to fruition, where we're able to leverage it with our respective partners and make sure that they feel resourced by Intel and that we're able to support them in their endeavors, whether it's finding new customers or changing the world through important technology. In the cloud, Intel has been very interested in Presto through our partnership with Ahana, who they have their managed SaaS model for Presto, as well as their commercial support on AWS. We've kind of homed in on some key instances that we think are really important. That's the R5 4 extra large and the R5 2 extra large for making the coordinator and Presto workers when spinning up that managed cluster. This is on our Intel Cascade-like technology, which really is going to give a great balance of price for a TCO perspective, as well as a performance perspective, making it kind of a key instance when you're making that end hardware decision. We think that this is very important that we continue to analyze this. And so we have existing engagements right now where we're taking some of their customers, we're working with them, and we're finding kind of a how-to guide and providing some key data that's going to be released very soon to make sure that when you're going to spin up Ahana on the cloud, you get the best possible Intel hardware and architecture as the foundation. On-premise, this is something we're also very interested in. We've had meetings with key members of the Presto community, as well as some key Intel architects and engineers, to make sure that we're able to kind of tailor our approach to Presto to best meet their needs, to make sure that our hardware stack is adequate and is able to make sure that they're able to use Presto affordably and at a high level. And one technology we think is really important, this is the Optane persistent memory. This is a very affordable comparative technology to DRAM that we think is going to continue to revolutionize the way that we move, transfer, and analyze data at scale. We want to make sure that latency is minimized and performance is maximized. And this is a great way to do it. So we're actively or internally evaluating ways that we can give back to the Presto community and make sure that some key existing users are able to get more and push their workflows to the next level, as well as future users are as well. We thank you very much for listening to the Intel session today. If there's any feedback that you can give to Intel for what we can do to help you, don't hesitate to reach out. Thank you. Have a great rest of your day.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Intel, for being part of the Presto Foundation and also collaborating and supporting the open source project. Up next, we have our second panel of the day, panel I've been quite anxiously waiting to listen to. We bring in Deepthi back as a moderator. Girish will be joining us as well. I have two new speakers who will be part of this panel. Let me first introduce David Simmons. He's the CTO and co-founder overseeing Ahana's technology strategy and drives most of the product innovation. And he has been in the industry for a long, long time. If you want to jump over to the speaker page and see all the work, exciting work David has done in the field of databases, and now his focus on making Presto better would be very exciting. And the other speaker I also wanted to introduce, panelist for this session, is Bishwa. Bishwa and I work at Facebook. Bishwa has been, he's the tech lead for a bunch of products, Presto, Spark, Streaming at Facebook, which is what we call as the data infrastructure compute engines. And he is looking at various modernization efforts at Facebook. So Deepthi, I will let you take over the panel from here and get some interesting insights from all our wonderful panelists. And Girish, I didn't reintroduce you, but you know, because you were here earlier in the day as well, but for folks who have maybe joined later, Girish not only is the chair of the Presto Foundation, but also the tech lead for the Presto project for Uber. So over to you, Deepthi.
All right, thanks Amit for the introductions. Great to be back on. Bishwa, Girish, and Dave, looking forward to this discussion. You know, we had an ecosystem panel earlier in the day, and it was quite fun talking about how broad Presto is and the ecosystem around it, connectors, layers on top, layers below. But this one is, you know, when we were talking earlier, is about the core engine, right? The innovation that's happening at the heart of the engine, and the innovation that's happening across multiple different companies as well. I think all of you, you don't need any additional introductions. So let's dive right into, you know, one of the first questions. You know, 6 months ago we had a discussion, and there's a lot that's happened in that time frame, in that period of time. Maybe each of you can share a little bit about what's changed, something that you have been really excited about that's been delivered in the past 6 months, something that's created a lot of impact. Girish, let's start off with you. Maybe share a little bit more about Presto at Uber and the things that are exciting, the game-changing things that are happening.
Sure. Thanks, Deepthi. Thanks for all the introductions. And hey, David and Biswa, nice to see you both again in this panel. At Uber, we've been focusing primarily on using Presto as an interactive engine. But over the last year, or 2020, we started off introducing this new product of being able to run ETL workloads on Presto. So we started out just before PrestoCon, and we just launched it for full usage around the same time. Over the last 6 months, we've seen amazing adoption of that. Right? So people are using it across the board. They're using it for all kinds of use cases. It's pretty amazing to see. So that is certainly one big success story I wanted to call out. The other thing we've been doing is we've been trying to establish Presto SQL, the SQL layer of Presto, as the de facto SQL for most data analytics use cases at Uber. And towards that, we've been working to port Presto SQL to platforms like Flink and Spark. On the Spark side, the Facebook guys have done amazing work. So we did a successful POC of the stuff they put out. We're very happy. We're waiting for GA before we launch it. On the Flink side, there are some interesting early results. I'll probably be sharing in future meetups. So that's cool stuff from the Uber side on Presto.
It's great. It's open source in action, right? Someone contributes in the innovation, and everyone else gets to use it. So, Bishwa, why don't you go next and maybe share about things that you've been excited about that have gone into production or have been delivered over the last 6 months?
Sure. Well, I think the two big ones, I would say, in terms of stuff that has landed well, one of them is the RaptorX effort. This is kind of the new set of enhancements to Presto that makes Presto significantly faster by deploying all sorts of techniques around, you know, caching data, caching partial results. A lot of the stuff, by the way, Alibaba people talked about earlier today, right? You know, smarter metadata caching, data caching, partial result caching, all that getting loose affinity. So basically, you have the benefits of disaggregated storage, but the performance of co-located, which is kind of really kind of a dream combo, right? If you think about it, and that's what we're going towards. I think RaptorX is a very good step in that direction. James talked about that earlier this morning for those who were there in quite a bit of detail. And the other one, which has just started landing, just going back to Girish's point about ETL, right? So we had this Presto LBM, right, where we were able to run large queries by materializing intermediate stages. Now we have Presto on Spark, which I'm very excited about because it actually allows you to run arbitrarily large petascale queries using the exact same Presto set of features and semantics and language, but leverages under the hood the Spark distributed runtime, and that gives you a host of advantages. It allows you to leverage elastic compute better. It allows you to, you know, size containers depending on the job, because you know it achieves much better isolation. You can run jobs for days and not fail because, you know, there is checkpointing at the individual task level. And I believe that this essentially takes the ETL use case of Presto to really to the next level. I'm very excited about where that particular project is going to go.
Rish and I talked earlier in the day about how the next phase of the Presto option is really around strategic replatforming, right? And that comes with starting with one use case and then another and another, and essentially expanding the platform to multiple use cases. So that's great to hear. Dave, you've been in the database space for a while. You know, what have you seen in the past 6 months? Perhaps share some perspectives.
Yeah, I mean, I joined this community about actually 7 months ago. So I've been building closed proprietary enterprise data warehouse systems for, I don't want to say how long, but it's like 3 decades. Like that. But what gets me excited is, and it's not new, I guess it's not new for everyone here, but it's new for me, it's sort of this emerging architectural pattern that is sort of looking to, let's say, augment the proprietary enterprise data warehouse by enabling query transactions, data management capabilities directly on cloud data that's residing in sort of these open formats. And so there's huge advantages to that, because, you know, otherwise data is sort of locked into these proprietary systems. So, you know, the term lakehouse, and Gartner's coined the term accelerated analytics for this pattern. So what's new is, so I'm excited by the launch of Ahana, which we launched in December of this year, with GA in December of this year, which sort of fits into this accelerated analytics architecture. And so there's a lot of interesting challenges there from a technical perspective. What we're trying to do is provide the equivalent of a fully featured data management system for the data lake. And it sort of opens up a lot of challenges. Like the first one being that we're, unlike a closed system, we're trying to build this fully featured system with a disaggregated stack of open services, such as those for metadata, for transactions, for security. And these services are largely shared across the various analytical engines that are in this accelerated environment. And then the other challenge, obviously, is that the data is ETL directly into the data lake. So it's the various analytical engines, including ours, has to sort of live with these open table layouts and file formats. So there may be some interesting innovations that we'll do there to deal with any suboptimality in the data layout. And obviously we've chosen PrestoDB as to provide the analytical SQL capabilities for this environment. So it's, you know, it's got great capabilities for analyzing these open data layouts and formats, and a really compelling technical roadmap that we're collaborating on, and a strong group of technologists like Girish and Biswa and his team. So yeah, PrestoCon is doing a great job of highlighting all these various aspects. So in short, I'm super excited about our launch, and that was the thing that sort of happened in the last months. Yeah.
Yeah, and I want to share a little bit on the community side, right? We have seen a lot of great contributions. So today, Twitter talked about the Iceberg Connector, and we're seeing that there are a lot more formats, whether they're table formats, whether they are more on the, you know, transaction manager, data management side. There are a range of different options that are out there. Apache Hadoop, we had a couple of, you know, we talked about it. Uber extensively uses it. And it's really good to see some of those being merged in and really being integrated with Presto. The other aspect is security. And security is, we've seen good progress in a couple of different ways. So it's obviously you need integration with existing tools that are in the ecosystem, like Ranger for fine-grained access control. But also in the cloud is it's a whole new paradigm. And what works there and the paradigms with AWS are sometimes very different with from the on-prem world, right? And so there's been a lot of good support added to AWS specific aspects as well, from S3 improvements, IAM improvements, from a security perspective. And that's been really phenomenal to see. So it's been a good 6 months. You know, it sounds like a lot has happened in the 6 months that since we talked last. Now, there are other projects. You know, it was funny, we were talking about this earlier. As an end user, you know, as a data platform engineer, there are many choices today. There are closed source choices, there are open source choices, there's do it yourself, there's managed services. You know, it used to be a world where there was Oracle, IBM, and Microsoft SQL Server, and life was easy. But now there are a lot of other options. And so let's talk a little bit about why a data platform engineer would pick Presto, right? What are the, from your perspectives, perhaps why did you, pick it and investing in it for your companies? And putting yourself in the end user shoes, why should they, you know, what is in Presto that they may not get with other options that are out there? So maybe Girish, you can Bishwa, you can get started with this one, and we'll go around.
Well, I think I can think of a few things. One big one, obviously, this is not a very obvious feature, right? But one of the things that we do at Facebook is that we run literally like tens or even hundreds of millions of queries on Presto and Spark. Like one of the things that we get, or rather the community gets, is I think this benefit of really, really exascale testing. Like over the last 2 years, we have essentially scaled Presto 10x. And you know, we have tested RaptorX with like beta scale, you know, multi-beta scale. With highly complex workloads, we have gone into the depths of org and kind of tuned the codex for example, extremely deeply nested repeated structured data, right? Arrays and maps and all those kind of things, right? We have heavily invested. I think like really, really complex. Like we have queries that have literally 100 joins, right? We have queries that are like, this is the query string is megabytes in size, right? And as the like the data model of Facebook is extremely complex, so we have done this like over the last 1.5 years, we have done a really extensive set of things about how to make like every correctness problem is like a step zero at Facebook, right? So this volume of testing that has gone over the last several years, I think, and we continue to, you know, 2x 3x every year, I think this is a huge value add that Presto provides, and it is kind of hard to underestimate the value. Like this is, Oracle literally has like hundreds of people working on like millions of queries trying to get this kind of thing going, right, for use. So I would say that, so that's a big one. And obviously the other use case is that because we are testing the limits of Presto, like if you look at this spectrum of like, you know, like thousands or even tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of queries of really, really tiny queries, all the way to, we just refer to this bad job that is going to run for days on Presto and Spark, right? And we are trying to make Presto cover this entire spectrum, right? And of course, there is other side of the spectrum, like how many connectors we have. Like we can talk to pretty much a lot of these different file formats, databases. So the surface area of coverage, both in terms of this spectrum of use cases and the amount of data and the type of data we have handled, I think it's kind of hard to get. If you take examples of Oracle, Microsoft, I think they can kind of only dream of the kind of depth and kind of breadth of the coverage we have, right? And we are getting continuously better. Like our pace, if anything, is accelerating. So I would say those are the two, like we'll talk about, you know, later, Velox and all the cool, like native code acceleration, like we are investing in, a lot of the other people in the community are investing in. So I would say, yeah, those are the main things.
Yeah, great point. Girish, do you just leave it to Facebook all the testing, or what is your perspective on it?
Yeah, I agree with Biswa that resiliency and reliability, those are basically the cornerstones why we've chosen Presto, right? So as I mentioned before, we were talking about this four-phase development and about how you adopt Presto within your individual organization, right? So at some point, you'll start hitting scale. And when you start hitting scale, everything else becomes secondary. Because when people start depending on Presto for getting their job done and it goes down, you're going to hear about it, right? And they're going to speak because now people's jobs are blocked. So for us, I don't think there is another comparable engine on the market in the open source space, which gives us the kind of guarantees that we get with Presto releases at Facebook, right? Yes, I mean, the features are important, but I want to be confident that if I deploy something at the download of the web and put it out to my thousands of users, I'm confident that I will not run into problems. Of course, I mean, Facebook does most of the work. We still have to do some additional work here because we use different technologies like Parquet and things like that. So we do some additional testing on our side, but the stability, the scale, those kind of things, I think, are sussed out by the Facebook testing process. Another thing I wanted to bring up very quickly. I think it's good to put yourself in the shoes of a data engineer here, right? So if, for instance, if you're a software engineer, your development process is you pull up an IDE, you try out some code, you write some unit tests on the side, you test it out, and then you do some development, and then you finally put it into staging and then production, and then that's your process, right? If you're a data engineer, it's a similar process, right? You first start with your SQL, you try it out on some small data sets, you explore the data, and then you figure out what is the SQL you want to push, and then you hit a button and it goes to production. Now, that production could be a big Spark job, it could be an always on streaming pipeline on Flink, let's say, or it could be like a IQPS query that you're putting on some external facing dashboard, right? For all the use cases, the development starts with a data engineer or data scientist sitting with a query builder type interface and doing some basic Presto queries.
Right.
And I think from my point of view, that's the reason, right? Like if people are starting with Presto, you want to make sure that they can go all the way. They don't have to move to another platform and they need to hit production or whatever. So that's another reason why I think it's important for us to invest in Presto.
Dave, anything more to add to that?
Yeah, I mean, obviously Presto is a great distributed, you know, ANSI SQL implementation. It's got support for everything you need to run, you know, TPCDS, Facebook's running it, you know, interactive SQL at the scale of multi-thousands of servers and multi-petabytes of data. So Biswan mentioned all that stuff, highly optimized for, you know, for ORC and Parquet data. So I would imagine a platform engineer will likely be looking to build out sort of their own open data lake based accelerated analytics environment, which is comprised of a bunch of shared services and best of breed analytical engines. So, you know, so did all the great stuff that Facebook's doing and Uber, and we'd like to collaborate with the deep tech, but then there's companies like Ahana that are looking to build the integrations for these types of accelerated analytics environments with the different types of metadata services. You mentioned security services like Ranger earlier, transactional services like Hoodie. So it's gonna, you know, so the combination of, you know, all this performance and scalability work and then all the integrations that will sort of enable Presto to work in this sort of accelerated analytics environment, I think over the next 12 to 18 months, and there's no better choice than sort of PrestoDB for this type of platform engineer.
Right? Yeah, and there's, I think, a big one is just the future roadmap, right? And there's a few questions around some of these things. You know, there's a question around resiliency, you know, when a worker node going down. And I know I've had this conversation with some of you here where it's like, oh, okay, can we get more fault tolerance with intra query that allows us to really use the power of the cloud and scale up, scale down in any way, right? So maybe Biswa, talk a little bit about that. You know, I think you've answered it. Anything more to add on the fault tolerance?
No. As I said, I think this is our top of our mind. Like we have very similar things at Facebook. Like we have this project called OPEC that, you know, is essentially about how do we bring like spot instances or elastic instances, as we say, right? And today we have kind of the solution where we bring up and down, you know, clusters on the fly based on certain parameters, and it kind of works, but not really. And this is actually one of the most important things we want to do. And as I said in the response to the question, with Presto and Spark, you kind of get that, right?
Yeah.
For ETL long running workloads, where it is the most important, really. Like, I mean, if you have a, you know, 1 minute job, you can just retry the query, right? It's a lot cheaper to do that. If you have a 10 hour job, then you just can't retry. So, but we actually do want to bring it, because apart from the fact that it So the, today, the problem is not only just resilience, the problem is actually at the other end of the spectrum. Because if you want to get very low latency, you need to be able to speculatively retry individual tasks in multiple workers. And I recommend everybody reads the Tail at Scale paper by Jeff Dean. It has a really fantastic explanation of why low latency requires speculative execution. Right, so we do want to bring this to classic cluster, and I do believe this will be a significant improvement in terms of actually improving the latency of interactive job, funnily enough. Mm-hmm. Right, so it actually works in both sides of the spectrum. So yeah, we are definitely going to work on this.
That's great. Now, in terms of the ecosystem, you know, there, let's talk a little bit about the extensions, right? So there's the code engine. We talked a little bit about that. We've discussed RaptorX today, a little bit about Aria. Are there other extensions that that you're looking at building, adding on to what already exists on Classic Presto? And maybe we can have a discussion around that. Dave, do you want to get started on this one first, perhaps, or Girish?
What was the question?
The extensions on Presto, around Presto?
Yeah, I mean, for us, I think it's sort of what I said earlier, right? The challenge for us is to provide, you know, capabilities like ACID transactions, data versioning, auditing, indexing, caching, cost performance, scalable query optimization execution via this disaggregated stack of services, right? So one set of integrations that we hope to bring to it is sort of, you know, like we contributed the Apache Ranger plugin as an example recently to the community. So we'll look to make extensions to provide capabilities like snapshot isolation, time travel, maybe ultimately rewrite transactions by exploiting services like Hoodie. You know, we come at it from a public cloud perspective. So, you know, extension to the Hive connector and RaptorX to fully utilize the full IO bandwidth of cloud object stores like S3. You know, using prefetching and parallel IO. So we'll help add performance extensions to the existing connectors. So those are sort of the examples of some of the things I think that we'll be investing in over time, over the next 12 to 18 months.
That's great. Girish?
Yeah, sure. So from Uber's side, I think one area of investment is around making Presto as the de facto data analytics ecosystem, right? And so what it means is you write your Presto SQL query, write out in the classic Presto, and then you're able to hit it to production in one of different ways. So we've already done some work on putting Presto for low latency, high QPS queries on top of Pino, Apache Pino. We're working with the Pino community on that and adding additional features like upsurge, joins, all this kind of stuff. So that is one area. The other area is when we talk about production at Uber, predominantly these jobs are essentially long-running streaming jobs, right? Like that's what we care about, real-time end-to-end. And a lot of that workload runs on Apache Flink. So as of today, people basically write jobs using either Java on Flink, or Flink comes out of the box with a CalSite SQL support. What we want to do is we want to take Presto SQL and be able to run these as Flink jobs. So that's another area we're investing in. And also Presto on Spark, the stuff that Facebook folks are working on. We try to talk, we love it, we want to partner and do more stuff. So those are the areas we're currently looking at.
All right. Vishwa, anything more to add to that from an ecosystem perspective?
I think this is all this stuff is great. I think I'm really excited. One thing I wanted to point out is that I think a convergence angle is kind of important. Like this the fact that we all need kind of this DMLs and kind of rich types and all of this stuff, right? And one of the challenges we have is that it is not all about Presto. Like for example, the file format we use, the metastore that we use, the metastore is a big one, is really gets in the way because you have to, a lot of these actually require like materialized views. You can't really do a good job with materialized views unless you have a very tight integration with Metastore. Same with real-time data, same with. So one of the things I'm really looking forward to is to how do we expand this collaboration where we can build this. And this is where, you know, like Databricks and Snowflake have a lot of advantage because they own and control the ecosystem through, you know, Delta or through Snowflake's own like FoundationDB based Metastore or whatever, that they can build these features much more quickly and much more efficiently. So this closed ecosystem, but that doesn't mean that the ecosystem has to be closed, right? We can still have an open ecosystem, but still converge on this, you know, richer protocols with the metadata and stuff. And those, I think that is, to me, is very exciting. And this is something that we have started seriously thinking about. What do we do there? Should we just en masse adopt Iceberg? Does it really scale to this million QPS end of the spectrum? I don't know. Should we just extend iMetaStore? Should we build something brand new that has all of these properties that can actually compete with Snowflake, for example? So not really. I mean, this ecosystem, this, I feel that is a cornerstone of building a truly competitive big data ecosystem.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, the interesting thing is the large internet companies see it one way, right? But when you have a three-person data platform engineering team, you see it very differently, and you just want it to work out of the box. And so, you know, from an Ahana perspective or a cloud services perspective, anything that takes just the query engine, you absolutely then need to say, okay, do I use bring up an instance just for the Hive Metastore, or do I connect to Glue? Right, which one or both? And some of the design choices that we've had to make are both, because there are advantages of the cloud services, obviously, because a lot of these cloud services may already be used by end users. But then there is a beauty of having a managed meta store that the a service is just taking care of for you, and you can build optimizations on top of that, which is what, you know, we are looking at. We just upgraded to Hive 3 as an example, so that we could leverage some of these capabilities in Presto, which don't exist. Add you know, DDL for it, or you know, add additional support for it, and optimize on top of it. But I think the flexibility of it for smaller teams that are not Facebook, Uber, Twitter—that is important. And you know, one of the things that solves it is a managed service. And somebody had a question earlier about, let me scroll up here, around Kubernetes, right? Because we are looking at Presto is—it's great. It's in some ways it's a stateless engine that can can be run in a containerized environment. For many of the managed services, they run on Kubernetes, some flavor of Kubernetes. And so the specific question around, you know, official support for perhaps an operator or a, you know, Kubernetes controller. Are you, Vishwa and Girish, are you using Kubernetes much with Presto at the moment, and any plans around that?
Oh, not really. I mean, Facebook has its own Kubernetes. Like we run on Tupperware. There's actually a paper on Tupperware, which was released last year. We also have a thing called Kronos, which essentially is kind of, think of it as a yarn equivalent. That is good for, you know, bin packing lots of small tasks at a per worker level. This is what we use for Spark, right? We don't currently have plans to adopt Kubernetes, I don't think so. But I'm really excited about the ability for Presto to run on different container management systems. I do know some of the old Kubernetes folks from Google days, like the Borg, right? Folks, and Borg is just freaking awesome, right? So if we can get something like Borg in the open source ecosystem, you know, I think it would be a very powerful thing.
Anything else to add, Dave or Girish?
Yeah, so from Uber side, we also have platforms built internally, similar to Kubernetes. So we have a stateless a job management or application management platform and a stateful one. And we're currently trying out Presto on both. But interestingly, at Uber, we are also considering looking at Kubernetes as we think of moving more and more of our compute into public cloud. And I'm pretty excited to try out Presto on Kubernetes. It might happen more on like the H2 timeline, but it's definitely something on the horizon for us.
Yeah, you know, as I architected the service, for Presto runs on EKS, and so for all customers that are on using Ahana actually are just running natively on EKS. They don't even know it. And that's the way it should be, where the underlying operating system essentially is a detail, right? And the rest of it is orchestrated. But we are looking at a Kubernetes operator to you know, just have more multi-cloud, and you know, we'll be open whatever we come up with will be open source. So we'll share more along the way later in the year. Let's move on to the last question, which is really about the future of Presto. And Bishwa, you have a State of the Union talk a little bit later in the day to go into. Everyone's been waiting for, you know, what is that? But maybe spill the beans a little bit for us in this session, just a teaser on what is coming. Girish and Dave, what are you excited about in the next 6 months? Right, we meet again in September at the big PrestoCon event, which will hopefully, maybe, perhaps in person. We'll see how it goes. Fingers crossed. but what, you know, what is it that you want to get done in the next six months, and what does the future of Presto look like?
6 months. Well, in my talk later, I think I'll talk a little bit about the next 6 years, more like. Well, but we'll cover a bit of the next 6 months as well. Immediate term, as I said, I think some of the things that we are coming down the line. One is that things like speculative execution and partial result streaming and things like that, which will make interactive space even better. We have got fragment result caches and all kinds of very interesting things on the interactive space. Presto and Spark getting more mature is something I'm really excited about, because this finally gives people a way to, you know, write their query once and just run it anywhere, whether it's a dashboard. In fact, one very exciting thing that this is unfortunately internal, that we are actually putting the same language on streaming as well. So we are doing this project called CoreSQL. I'll talk a little bit about that, which basically takes Presto SQL and adds a bunch of streaming graph, rich types, and other extensions, and makes that kind of the lingua franca for people who have come from Google. I think Google SQL, which is open source at Jira SQL, kind of is trying to achieve very similar goals. And I'm excited about that kind of maturing in the next 6 months, right? I think Velox, a lot of people have been asking me, I'll talk a little bit in my our C++ native accelerator story. I feel that is going to hopefully land in the next 6 months, at least for some initial workloads. I'm excited about that. Oh, and also the, you know, just the scale stuff, like things like Firebolt and PrestoPack. I think Tim talked about Firebolt, or Swapnil talked about Firebolt.
We'll be talking about it.
Oh, okay. Just scaling Presto to larger and larger cluster and elastic resources and those kind of things, right? We have a bunch of things in flight that we expect to land in the open source and internally over the coming 6 month-ish timeframe. Especially, I think Firebolt is something I'm really, really looking forward to, because that will, I think, be a game changer in terms of high availability and elastic clusters and large clusters and things like that.
Awesome. Firebolt equals multiple coordinators or disaggregated coordinators, yeah, for those who aren't familiar with the project name, the code name. Dave, what are you looking forward to in terms of the future of Presto, and what do you have on your mind?
Yeah, exactly. So Bishwa is going to outline a pretty compelling technical roadmap that they're driving. I think the most interesting thing to me is the next gen native worker and all the surrounding the new native Hive connector and all the work around that. So that more than likely will give up to an order of magnitude performance improvement over the next, however, 12 to 18 months or however long it takes. So we're specifically, I have like four or five open headcount that are looking to hire into those projects to try to help accelerate that part of it. So that's how excited I am about it. So we actually want to help them and help accelerate that work. So as you pointed out, so it's not just performance too. It's you pointed this out earlier. It'll help eliminate the GC storms and the out of memory by allowing spilling and proper LARTs query evaluation techniques for sorting and hashing, which is pretty out there. From the ANA perspective, I mentioned earlier all the integrations, the public cloud bent. Improve price performance. We have a pretty strong query optimization team. We're going to try to be really benchmark driven, and so run a lot of industry benchmarks like TPCDS, for example. Like Snowflake publishes that they can run 100 terabyte TPCDS in 3 hours on X size cluster. What can we do? What can Presto do? You know, in this open environment, right? So I think, you know, we're going to put a big focus on industry benchmarks and query optimization and distributed query execution techniques to help drive performance there. We'll commit all this back to open source. I'm sort of scratching around the surface of like data science meets database capabilities now that I'm on the cloud. So I want to sort of leverage machine learning and observation and AI machine learning techniques to sort of, you know, help solve the auto configuration, auto tuning, workload optimization, and other such improvements. So I'm talking to one of my old colleagues from Aster Data Systems, who's a really good data scientist, to start, you know, figuring out what we can do there. So I think there's going to be like the next 12 to 18 months is going to be super, super exciting for Prusa to be in so many dimensions.
That's great. Girish, any last comments?
Yeah, so from Uber's side, we're looking at three major areas. So one is the Presto ecosystem stuff I was talking about, the Presto on Flink, Presto on Pinot, Presto on Spark, that kind of stuff. So obviously more investments there, hopefully more workloads running on those kind of configurations. The second thing is we're also trying out, like I mentioned, Presto on public cloud. So Kubernetes, Google Cloud, that kind of stuff. So this gives us elasticity, which we usually don't get with our on-prem systems, right? So if you're peak load, you can always spin up a cluster very quickly on Google Cloud and can take some of your load. So we're trying that out. It sounds pretty exciting to us right now. And then the third area is actually pretty interesting. I think something we didn't touch on too much in this panel, but I feel is fundamental, right? So there's two ways you can optimize your query. One is you can optimize the engine, and the second is you can optimize the data, right? And the way you optimize the data is basically you look at the queries that people are running, and then you reformat your data in a way that those queries run faster. So for instance, you could have sample tables of your huge fact tables, or you could resort your data in a different way. You could aggregate kinds of like statistics in your footer files, and that will speed up your queries, certain classes of queries. So that's another area, data layout optimization. That's an area we are heavily investing in. So hope to see some of that work.
We should talk about this offline.
Hey, we say that every time. One more thing, Girish, that came up with Uber is secondary indexing. And that I think is very interesting as well. Just auxiliary data structures that, you know, up until now, we've depended on the Parquet and ORC and the metadata that's essentially within the format itself. And is there other ways that, you know, it could, where auxiliary data structures, like, depending on, there's so many different ways of indexing, would help as well. And so that's something I think the community has been asking for as well. All right. Well, we've had, we're just on time, frankly. And so thanks so much, Bishwa, Girish, Dave, always a pleasure. Thank you for your insights, and and we'll see Bishwa. We'll see you later in the day. Back to you, Amit.
Yeah, thank you. This was very, very enjoyable. Thank you for your time. Thank you for all the insights. And Bishwa, I'm definitely looking forward to your next session in about 20 odd minutes. Before that, we have two more lightning talks that we want to get in. The first one is a talk by Omar Muhammad. He's a senior data engineer at Cortana, and his session is on Presto on AWS using the Ahana Cloud at Cortana. So let's get that session going.
Hello, everyone. My name is Omar Muhammad. I'm a data engineer here at Cortana. I'm here to talk about our experience using Presto and Ahana, why we needed to use Presto in the first place, and how it benefited our business and made our lives easier. But first, let me introduce you to Cortana. Cortana is one of the fastest growing B2B e-commerce marketplaces in the MENA region, in North Africa and the Middle East, that connects retailers with suppliers, wholesalers, and production companies. We provide a mobile application, iOS and Android, for retailers to browse different products and suppliers, compare prices, place their orders, and have them delivered in just a few steps. We also have an app for suppliers to update their prices, place special offers, and track their orders. We are also providing 24-hour support for retailers and suppliers to make sure everything is always running smoothly. We are exponentially growing with tens of thousands of orders placed monthly through the app. We continue to directly integrate with Egypt's and the Middle East's biggest suppliers including Unilever and Coca-Cola. But to stay ahead in a highly competitive market, we need to study the incoming data and quickly adapt to the changes and trends. We have a fantastic BI and growth team that is continuously working hard to drive our business forward and help us focus on the right metrics. The BI team mainly uses Redash, as we see in this figure, to connect to our different databases and data warehouses. So basically, we have the transactional database, which is our main database that logs the main transaction in our system, like orders and users. And we have an analytics database, which is a playground for the analytics and BI team to make their experiments and calculate other metrics that could be important. We also have a timescale DB to log the changes in our data, like the prices and so on. And we have the retailer events warehouse and the supplier events warehouse. We are using Segment to track events across our apps and log the different interactions that users have with our applications to help recommend and personalize their experiences. And like mentioned earlier, we have Redash at the heart of the operation to help the BI team visualize and bring forth their the important metrics to the business team. So this is the number of records that gets synchronized every 12 hours from Segment. Of course, we're using Segment with different sources and destinations. This is a single source, which is a retailer app writing into our data warehouse. So we can see that every 12 hours or every synchronized, we get around 200,000 events written to the database. And with our increased number of users and growth, we can imagine how difficult it will be in the upcoming months to keep track of all this information and drive insights from them. So it began to make sense that we need some tool that can help us in keeping track of all this information. So as the data size grew larger, some limitations started to appear. For instance, getting the whole picture is now was proving difficult as the number of databases and data warehouses was increasing. It became difficult to make reports that leverage information from our different sources. The BI team started writing different syntaxes and query languages depending on the source they were dealing with. So it was getting more complicated each week. And we also started noticing some complex queries with our increased data sizes, that some queries were taking a long time to execute. So it became clear to us that we need to use something like Presto, as it will enable the BI team to join across our different databases and data warehouses while unifying the syntax and making the queries run faster. But deploying Presto into a production level can get a bit challenging. First, you need to deploy and configure your different workers, the coordinator, and the Hive Metastore if you don't have it. And you need to be able to scale up or down depending on your usage, either vertically or horizontally. You also need to be able to monitor the cluster at all times, get notified if anything unexpected happens, and health check the cluster at all times. And this is where Ahana comes in. Ahana removed all the difficulties and challenges of deploying Presto to our production environment and granted us control over the cluster with scaling up and down options. We were able to accomplish that within an hour in a call. After that, we were able to easily connect 3-Dash to Presto directly and could fully enjoy the full benefits of having Presto in our disposal. We performed a benchmark on one of our most important dashboards. The dashboard includes around 38 heavy queries that are vital to our business and growth. So we see in the figures that before using Presto to refresh the whole dashboard and the whole queries, it took around 60 seconds. After Presto, it went down to 27, which is impressive enough, but with some small optimization, like using approximates when we don't need the exact numbers, and using regular expressions instead of writing multiple like statements, we went down to 15 seconds, which is around 75% decrease in time. So now we are able to join across our different databases without having to copy or ingest data. It's all done in place in Presto, which saved us hours of planning and manual work from the PI team. Also, our PI team has only now to write SQL syntax, no matter the database they are communicating with. Our PI team managed to make new dashboards linking between the analytics database and the events warehouse. And with the help of these dashboards, we managed to make new recommendations for our users and make their experience more personalized. And now we have simple configuration control over our Presto cluster. The power to scale up and down the workers and change the instance type if we want to scale up or down vertically. And we don't have to worry about health checking the cluster to make sure everything is working as intended. So now we can focus on reaching a million order and growing our business further without having to worry about the little details. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Amar. This was very, very insightful. Thanks for sharing how Presto and AWS using Ahana has been beneficial to your business. Up next, I would like to bring in Swapnil, another one of my colleagues from Facebook. He's been part of the Presto team as well, works on the resource management at Presto. So today, his lightning talk is going to be about disaggregated coordinators. Over to you, Swapnil.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Hey, so without wasting more time, I'll just jump onto the presentation. This is about the disaggregated coordinator, aka Firewall, or multi coordinator. So Firewall is the internal project code name in Facebook. So the motivation, why are we doing it? So with the current architecture in the Presto, we have a single coordinator and multiple workers, and that worked well for many years. But at Facebook, we started to feel some of the challenges with the existing architecture. The first of them is with the existing architecture, we can't, the coordinator to worker ratio, there is an upper limit with that. So as we increase the more workers into the cluster, the coordinator gets overwhelmed with the workload. And that leads to, we need to think about how we're gonna scale the coordinator. We can solve this problem by having like multiple smaller clusters running behind a load balancer, but that leads to a resource fragmentation issue where some of the clusters will have a high queue onto a given resource group while other clusters will have a lower load. This leads to if you want to solve it, we need to have a higher end machines to run the coordinator. But at Facebook, we are actually migrating our entire clusters to a lower end, lower CPU and memory machines. So that leads us to rethink about how we want to scale the coordinator. So the objective of this design is we want the flexibility to increase the coordinators into the coordinator pool, similar way as we have the workers. At the same time, we want to support more workers in the cluster. We also want to avoid a single point of failure. As you can see in the existing architecture, coordinator is a single point of failure. By supporting multiple coordinators in a cluster, we want to avoid that problem. And another thing is we want to support coordinator to run on a low CPU, low memory hardware, at the same time supporting more workers in the cluster. So here's the new architecture where we are introducing a new component called Resource Manager. It's going to be a pool of resource managers running in a cluster, and they each one of them is going to be behaving as a master. The job of the resource manager is actually aggregating the resource group information at the cluster level, the discovering of the nodes running in the cluster, cluster management, and UI endpoints. And as you can see, the coordinator has changed from a single coordinate to like a pool of coordinators. They are running behind a load balancer. And the fundamental work of the coordinator is not much change, as in it's going to be accepting the queries, analyzing, parsing, and executing the queries. Some of the decisions it's going to make with the help of the resource manager's information. One of the things the coordinator is going to be doing is regularly sending a query heartbeats to the resource manager. This will help the resource manager to generate the aggregated resource group information running within the cluster. And that is been later reused by the coordinator to make the queuing and running new queries decision. And the UI endpoints, so resource manager is going to be having the cluster level UI endpoints. So any cluster level information that coordinator needs to pull, they can fetch it from the resource manager. The worker pool's work is also, it's going to be same. There's only slight change in the worker pool where it's going to be sending the worker heartbeats to the resource manager. And this information has been used by the resource manager to generate the cluster level memory pool information that has been later used by the coordinator to decide on the home killer, as which queries to kill in case cluster is running out of memory. So that's a high level architecture of this system. And we in Facebook, we put this our clusters behind a load balancer. It is similar to what we heard in the earlier sessions, like a Prism or any other load balancer that the other companies are using. It's currently not open source from our side, and we have some logic around like how a new query comes in to which specific coordinator that query should go. But with this new system, any out-of-the-box load balancer can be put on top of the cluster, and normal load balancing can be used to work with this. So going to the next, it's a query execution. So with the resource manager's introduction, so one thing I think I might have missed is like the resource managers are going to be working in a multi-primary mode. So this means they are not also become a single point of failure. And the discovery service, which we used to run in the coordinator in the current architecture, that's just for the convenience. And we are moving that also into the resource manager. And there'll be multiple discovery servers running one per resource manager. So coming to the query execution. So the slight change in the query execution. So query has been submitted to one of the coordinator. coordinator is going to be parsing the query and assigning a resource group to the query. But once the resource group has been assigned, coordinator starts sending the regular query heartbeat to the resource manager. So this helps resource manager to generate the aggregated view of the overall clusters, how many queries are running under each resource group. And coordinator is actually enhanced to regularly pull this aggregated resource group information from the resource manager at a regular interval, which will be used later on, as I said earlier, to decide when a new query comes in to see whether it's eligible to run or whether we should queue it based on the resource group configuration. So once the coordinator decides that the query can run, it's actually also been enhanced to regularly pull the active workers available in the cluster from the resource manager. And that has been used to actually distribute the query plan. And then the rest of the query execution works as normal. And as you can see here, the worker pools are sending their work heartbeats to the resource manager at a regular interval. At the same time, the discovery server is running on top on the resource manager. So this helps the resource manager to have all the available nodes information at its place. So that can be provided as and when needed by the coordinator. Memory management. So the resource group needs an up-to-date CPU and memory statistics for the cluster. And it gets that by getting regular query heartbeats from the coordinator, which includes the query CPU and memory usage. At the same time, the regular worker heartbeats that is been sent by the workers, which includes the memory pool information. So together, using this information, the resource manager generates the aggregated memory pool information. And this information has been regularly pulled by the coordinator, which it uses to decide on the umgilling, as in if the cluster is running out of memory, it identifies which query to kill. Now, as you can see here, like resource managers are in multi-primary mode. So to make sure like they'll have an up-to-date information, the worker heartbeat's been sent to the each of the resource manager, and the same way query heartbeat is also being sent to each of those from the coordinator, each of the resource managers. This makes sure like each resource manager will have an up-to-date information about the entire cluster. Next, so resource management. So with this new resource manager's introduction, we have some changes around like how the resource management work. So what the resource group manager is going to be running on the coordinator, and it as I said before, so the regular query heartbeat's been sent to the resource manager. So resource manager has an holistic view of the entire cluster's resource groups, and coordinator is regularly coordinator can pick one of the active resource manager to pull this information at a regular interval, and the resource group manager is going to be using this information to decide on like let's say resource group A has a coordinator one is running two queries in resource group A, and coordinator two is also running three queries on resource group A, and the total concurrency for that resource group is five, which means like we can't allow in a cluster more than five queries running within that resource group. So when a new query comes into any of the coordinator will have an information that for this resource group, there are five total queries running as it's pulling that information from the resource manager. And for the new query, it just queues that into the queue rather than letting it run till the queue out of the five query, one of the queries finished. So that's how the new resource management is going to work in this new architecture. Next, discovery service. So as I said before, in the current architecture, discovery server is running on the coordinator, but that's just a matter of convenience. With this new architecture, we have moved the discovery server to run on the resource manager. Here, just for simplicity, I did not put it as part of the resource manager, just to show like discovery servers are also not a single point of failure. So what happens is, like, as part of the discovery service, each of the component, coordinator, resource manager, and worker, are regularly announcing their status to the discovery server, one of the active discovery server. And the discovery servers within them keep syncing this information using the distributed mode. And this is something a discovery server provides that information, provides out of the box. And coordinator be contacting one of the discovery server to regularly fetch all this information. So it just keeps regularly pulling this information to get that to it, right? The UI. So each coordinator is actually capable to serve the UI request. When a request comes to the coordinator, if the request requires the cluster state information, coordinator redirects those requests to one of the active resource manager. And the resource manager has a parallel endpoint to serve the cluster level information. And when a queries request comes to the coordinator, which the coordinator itself is not running. So let's say a cluster has two coordinators and a query B is running on the coordinator 2, but the UI request comes to coordinator 1, A, then the coordinator A sends that request to one of the active resource managers, and the resource manager has the holistic view of, like, which coordinator is running this query. So it just proxies that request to the specific coordinator and fetches the results and returns it back. So the current status of the project. So we are feature complete and in the shadow testing mode. We are extensively testing it with our production workload and making sure that the performance of the system is up to the par. And here's the link provided for the issue and the pull request that we are working with. And soon we are planning to provide a test branch to the community so that they can start doing their own testing and play around with the feature. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Swapnil. I think the only question was really about, you know, when do we have this? And you have shared the link for the test branch that should be available soon. So Akshay, keep an eye out on the links that Swapnil had shared. And thank you once again for, you know, this talk. The last session of the day, bringing back Bishwa again. For those of you who missed the panel discussion, Bishwa is the lead of the data infrastructure compute engines at Facebook, which is Presto, Spark, streaming, and looking at the modernization efforts at Facebook. So his last session and the last technical session of the day by him is also about Presto at Facebook, State of the Union. So we would love to hear from Bishwa, you know, all the exciting things that are happening. Eventually, they'll find their way to the community and, you know, we'll start, you know, the collaboration going. I will be signing off, you know, and Deepthi will come and wrap up the session after Bishwa. But, you know, just to let you know, there is some fun music trivia, which is happening after Bishwa's talk. If you remember last time at PrestoCon, we had a fun game. So there's going to be fun trivia this time as well. So stay back after Bishwa's session and I will sign off and leave you all in the good hands of Bishwa and Deepthi. Thank you. Over to you, Bishwa.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, Amit. I don't know how much time I have, 20 minutes. Let's just go over this stuff quickly. And by the way, I'm not sure if I'm still on the old session in terms of the chats. So press start Facebook. Okay, let me click on this. What happens? Oh, shoot. It asked me to leave. Never mind. I'll just take it.
I'm able to see you. I think we should be good.
Yeah, no, I'm just wondering if I'm in the chat, in the right chat session, because I'm still in the old chat session, it seems, for the...
No, it should be fine. I think this is like one unified session. So I think
we're okay. I'm just going to do a test. Let's see if you can see that. Okay, cool. And by the way, please feel free to post questions in the session as we go through this. I'll try to be brief. So Tim, I think, covered a lot of this earlier today. So I'll try to kind of zoom through the stuff that is already covered and focus more on things that maybe are slightly more long range, right? And this was kind of a mission statement that we had at Facebook. We created this as part of a, you know, Presto team mission. I'll just let that be, right? You know, it's the usual yada yada. Okay, but this is an interesting one, right? I want to spend a little bit of time on this. I think there are two types of trends. There's this usage trends and there's environmental trends. So on the usage side, I think we've heard a lot. Like there's an explosion of data. People need to scale. There's a real strong need for freshness and latency, like real-time data, really fast queries, lots of queries. Standardization is a big problem. We have N meta stores, we have N query dialects, you know, we have N ways of transforming data, et cetera, et cetera. A lot of people, I think Kishore touched upon this earlier. We're talking about exporting analytics to our users. So like, I think a very trivial example of this is, you know, when you go to YouTube, you see the number of like count on a given video. It's kind of analytics, right? That you're measuring the likes and views and things like that on YouTube, but you're exporting this at like a million QPS to, you know, billions of people. It's an interesting, different kind of analytics. Like, so it's not really the traditional data warehousing. Privacy and security, I think multiple people touched upon this, is becoming a very big deal, like with GDPR, with all sorts of hacks going on. You know, how can we prevent people from, you know, how can we prevent data leakage? How can we deploy all this privacy and compliance rules on our query engines and our data? Auto awesome. This is a name that I have coined. I think this comes from the BigQuery term, but fundamentally, like, there is less and less patience for people to actually spend hours fine-tuning their query performance because they need to run ad hoc queries very quickly, right? And, you know, time is money, and people want to say that, hey, I'm just going to tell you the SQL and you should just automatically figure out how to run it really fast, how to optimize my data underneath it. And if you look at cloud warehouses like, you know, BigQuery, Snowflake, Redshift, like a lot of, they are doing this kind of thing. And this requires actually a whole ecosystem optimization. I'll talk a little bit about that later. Data models are becoming very complex. How do we represent graph data structures? How do we do full text stores? How do we do, you know, really rich models? Like, how do we represent classes in our structures? Like, how do we have maps and arrays and have really efficient processing on them? And finally, richer query methods. So we talked about, you know, we started with simple SQL. Now we are talking about graph queries. We're talking about streaming extensions to SQL. We're talking about time series extensions, JSON processing, semi-structured. And these require like different kinds of optimization, different kinds of query strategies. So moving on to environmental trends, this is like how the industry is evolving, right? I don't mean environment in the environment sense, right? This is about more about like the computer environmental trends. Storage disaggregation is a big deal, right? S3 and all these blob stores, like your storage is separate, your computer is separate. A lot of people talked about this scaling, horizontal scaling. This comes from the data explosion. Your machines are getting smaller, but you get way more of them, right? How do we scale to, you know, 1,000 node cluster, 10,000 node clusters, like hundreds of clusters? And then kind of with that is elastic compute. How do we kind of gain elasticity? Like machines are coming in, going out, spot instances. Like you want to be able to leverage, quickly spin up, turn down machines, and kind of still the query should continue to work. Power efficiency is one of the interesting things that is coming in at Facebook a lot. Hey, we have a lot of data centers. Our data centers consume a lot of power. We might become power constrained in the future. Like, how do we make things more efficient just from a power consumption standpoint, whether it is, you know, power consumed by CPUs or RAM or network and things like that. And I think global optimization, I touched upon. Like, how do we, it's beyond the query engine. Like, how do we have much richer metadata or much richer stats? How do we automatically optimize the data layout so that query patterns can get faster? And finally, engineering efficiency. We have an explosion in the number of tables and the amount of data and the number of users who want to be data enabled, so to say. And we can't really scale our engineering. So we have to find our superscaler or the superscaler ways of scaling our data with not really the linear scaling of the number of engineers. So Facebook data is growing by whatever, 2x, 10x. A lot of our data is growing by 10x in some cases, right? You cannot just keep 10xing your engineering team. So we have to find much more engineering efficiencies out of the system to figure out how to deal with that. So I was going through my old albums, and this one was interesting. This, I don't know if people know about this group. This group is called Four Non-Blondes. They were really good, all girls rock group, right? And their big hit album was called Bigger, Better, Faster, More. And it got me to thinking that, hey, this is a great way to describe some of the stuff we are doing in Presto and in the overall ecosystem at Facebook. And the number three song, I don't know if you can notice this, on their album was actually their most popular or hit song. It was called What's Up, right? So what's really up? And I think, and What's Up is really bigger, better, faster, more. So let's talk about that starting like on the way down. So Presto and Spark, we talked about it. Like, how do we go big? Like running 10-hour queries, you know, without failing. Disaggregated coordinators, how do we go big on scale? Intelligent workload placement, Presto Park, we didn't talk much about that. How do we can touch upon that a little bit. How do we space out our tasks in a way that is really intelligent, can make our workers do more? Auto-awesomize, right? We touched upon this in the first trend, trend slide. Storage and metadata co-optimization. Again, like how do we do global optima? We talked a lot about RaptorX and caching and affinity. This is getting gradually from the better to the, you know, kind of the faster part of the equation, right? And the native code accelerator Velox. I saw a bunch of questions around that, so I'll touch upon that a little more. Then Core SQL. We'll talk a little bit about Core SQL. How do we take Presto SQL and take it to the next level in terms of just the language richness, right? And portable UDFs, which kind of on the similar lines, like how do we go beyond SQL when we really need to go into your Java and C++ or whatever, right? How do we enrich SQL using that? So let's start with Presto and Spark. I think we touched upon this in multiple sessions, but this is something that I'm really excited about because we see that essentially breaking down the scalability limits of Presto, make it run reliably on elastic hardware, on spot instances, on queries that run for, you know, tens of hours or even days, but with 100% Presto SQL compatibility, right? So we do that by essentially leveraging Spark as the underlying distribution framework. So it gives you a split level checkpointing, retries, job level isolation, like much higher reliability, like much better isolation, ability to run on elastic compute. This is feature complete, like we are kind of, this is in open source. We are productionizing the first few pipelines. We are seeing some really great results. We are able to share resources with our, you know, broader Spark clusters and the overall kind of the machine kind of resource allocation framework. This is really cool, right? So this is kind of from the bigger end of the spectrum. And then Swapnil just talked about this one, which is what we internally call Firewall, but basically how do we do disaggregated coordinators so that we can have, you know, 1,000 node, 2,000 node, 5,000 node Presto clusters with like maybe a dozen coordinators, right? And it still works. There is no, so it has two aspects. One is, it allows us to run larger, fewer clusters with elasticity and all that kind of stuff. But another important aspect is that this gives you much higher availability. So there is no single point of failure, right? The resource manager is kind of duplicated. The discovery service is duplicated. The coordinators are disaggregated. The workers were obviously, you know, horizontally scalable before, but this brings the scalability to a, you know, whole new dimension. Again, we are going through the final, this is not quite in production yet. It is going under heavy testing. Most of it is kind of feature complete in development. This is in open source, totally tried out. Presto Pack, we didn't talk a lot about that. This is a really cool little piece of work that Jem and others did. The idea is basically about today, the workload placement is Presto is pretty random. And this is actually cool because with disaggregated storage, you can do, you know, any work can run on any node, but this doesn't really give you a very good kind of, what should I say, uniform placement. So we should be able to do much better by intelligently deciding which piece of task goes where. So for example, in RaptorX, we choose an affinity-based model so that we can better leverage caching. But in batch mode, where there is no caching, you should be able to choose, say, a CPU-based model or a memory available-based model. So we have been trying these different models. For batch, we tried memory availability-based model, and we got a 23% higher throughput, which is actually a pretty big deal at Facebook scale. And again, this is kind of beginning to land. I think we are doing some shadow testing. Okay, this is an area that we haven't done a lot of work, and this is something that I think we should do a lot of work on, and we'll probably do it. But how do we make our warehouse auto-awesomize? And what do I mean by auto-awesome is that not only do we smart rewrites on the queries, like we employ cost-based optimizations, this requires tight Metastore integration, right? So we need to have richer stats. We need to do history-based optimization. This is something we are beginning to look at. We haven't done a lot. We have done a little bit, I think, which is like, how do we determine, hey, should this be a broadcast join or a hash join? We don't know, right? Today, in most cases, we don't know. Or we can guess based on stats, but it's not very accurate. But we can guess based on history. and this is something that we are beginning to poke at. Say, hey, we have a lot of these repetitive query patterns. Can we use historical data to make much better judgment calls on what the right execution strategy should be? Speculative execution, somebody asked me this question. Yes, we are looking at it. Basically, if your machine is stuck or failed, does it mean that the entire query needs to be retried, which is kind of expensive? Or can we actually only retry those fragments? Today, Presto's design makes that kind of tricky, right? And we have to disentangle a lot of these details in order to make this happen. So we're going through that. And this actually allows you another very interesting characteristic, which is adaptive execution. So can we change your joint parallelism or even your joint type or your aggregate parallelism depending on where in the running stage you are? And this requires you to disaggregate not only your not only the stats, but it requires and the data, it requires you to disaggregate your intermediate data, what we call the shuffle, because you might want to make a different decision or change the plan on the fly while the query is running, based on, you know, the results of where the query is today and what you have found out about the query based on where it is today. So this is something, again, kind of tricky. It requires a bunch of fairly intricate surgery. We are beginning to look at it. Talk to me offline if you're interested in this space. Okay. This is another area where I feel like we are lagging behind. And I touched upon this in earlier in the chat group, that one of the problems we have today is that the storage and metadata space is very fragmented. So even though all of us use Presto and Spark, the reality is that, you know, some people use Arc, some people use Parquet, some people use S3, some people use GCS, some people use HDFS, some people use Hive Metastore, some people use Iceberg, some people use Delta. And the problem with this fragmentation is that it becomes very difficult for us to do this whole stage optimization. So we are taking a bunch of small steps, and this is a relatively new area. We are looking at, you know, introducing Z-order and granular partitioning in our data, right? And making Presto take advantage of richer partitioning methods. We are looking at improving Arc through better encoding and other kind of format enhancement, like smarter footers, more richer metadata embedded in Arc. One thing that I'm particularly excited about is this usage-based layout decisions. This is something actually Snowflake and BigQuery and a lot of the warehouses do, which is looking at the query patterns to say, hey, these are the most frequently used columns. Maybe, you know, when I create the Arc file, I write them first. Or these are the most frequently used filter columns. Maybe I should automatically partition the data on that so that our, you know, queries become better. Or these files are too small. It only has like 10 rows per stripe. Maybe we should automatically compact these files into bigger files. Like, how do we do this automated column ordering, row reordering, richer metadata-based decision, history-based decision in terms of not only the query optimization, but in terms of data layout. And we have a team who is kind of a V team that is looking at this, automating this entire process, and in also introducing richer kind of Z-order clustering. Again, it's early days, but we are very excited by the initial promise that is shown by this area. We talked a lot about RaptorX. This, I think James gave a very good talk on this. Briefly speaking, it's all about caching and affinity, right? Roughly speaking, we are caching data at various stages, raw data, metadata, partially computed fragments, result caches. We are getting really, really good performance. The goal is obviously to at least match, if not beat, the performance of co-located storage while the storage is still disaggregated. We have actually achieved that. In some cases, we actually get better results than the co-located Raptor model. And this is because of like a complex set of issues. Like we can, for example, soft affinity allows us to reroute the individual split to a different worker if one worker is overloaded. So in aggregate, you actually make it better utilization, better throughput, and, you know, better latencies. This is all in production. You should definitely try it out. Okay, a lot of questions about native code acceleration. So let me spend a little bit of time on that. This is this little graph on the right. The leftmost bar, which is zero, this indicates where the Java code is faster. And the rightmost bar is 10, which is indicate where the C++ node is 10x faster than, an order of magnitude faster than Java. Now, the graphs on the two extremes are really thin, right? But if you notice, the median of this is kind of 5 or 4. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, which is pretty astonishing because we have spent a lot of time, you know, tuning our Java eval. And what we are finding now with our C++ native vectorized eval is that we can, on at least the initial fairly simple and admittedly somewhat biased query patterns, right, which are just doing filter project aggregate, whatever, on a single node, we are seeing 4x better CPU performance. And memory performance is better too. We haven't fully measured that. So how do we achieve that? We essentially have taken this fairly large task of rewriting the core eval engine of Presto in C++, right? And during this process, we are really going all out. Like we are doing very, very tight native memory control. We are exploiting all the nooks and crannies of C++ template metaprogramming. We are, you know, explicitly calling SIMD intrinsics. We are doing state-of-the-art vectorize and code gen techniques. We have a team in LLVM. We're trying to code gen the most the slowest and the most complex expressions and hook them into this into the kind of the eval tree on the fly to get better results. And these results don't reflect that, by the way. And the other nice thing that we are doing, going back to this unification convergence theme, that this is being built as a standalone library and this can potentially be used beyond Presto. So we are using it in Spark. Initial results look really good. You can think of it like a Photon equivalent. We are using it in our streaming processing system called Xtreme. It's not in production yet. This is fairly early in the development phase. Initial numbers look really good. We intend to open source it at some point. We are gradually opening up access to some of our, you know, early adopters, partners. Again, if you're interested, talk to me offline. We can give you more details or early access and things like that. Okay, SQL. SQL standardization is a big problem. And this core SQL project is essentially about taking Presto SQL, enriching it with all the latest SQL 16 goodness, with graph extensions, streaming extensions, rich types, like, you know, distinct types, enums, name types, and making that available to all the surfaces. So going back to the Presto on Spark is actually, if you think about it, another way of looking at Presto on Spark is now you have the full richness and functionality of Presto SQL, but using the Spark as the execution framework. So you don't have to rewrite your queries into Spark SQL or SQL if you just want to leverage Spark. You can still keep using Presto SQL. We are doing the same thing with our streaming engine, which is kind of an internal proprietary C++ based thing, which is called Xtreme. We are embedding Velox. We have a core SQL C++ front end that a team is writing, the UPM team is writing. I think this is a very interesting and exciting kind of world where we really want to align on the dialect, right? So the grammar and the main parser of core SQL, Srini has written this new Java CC-based grammar. This is directly derived from SQL 16 standard. We have added all the Presto extensions to it. We have added graph and streaming extensions. We are adding graph and streaming extensions to it. Check it out, it's already open source. We are doing some lightweight integration with Presto right now, hopefully a deeper integration, which will essentially get rid of the existing Presto Antler-based parser and replace it with this one, is on the way. And portable UDFs. So this is a very common problem. People often say that, hey, Hive UDFs are only Java only, they run in Spark, they don't run in Presto. Presto has its own way of writing functions, but that is embedded Java. We have a lot of code which is in Java, but we also have a lot of code which is in C++, with Hack, in Python. And how do we reuse this when we want to break the shackles of SQL and go into, you know, deeper programming? So portable UDF is our method. Rongrong is the person driving this from the Facebook side. The idea is that you establish certain protocols of metadata and the data plane on how to interface with out of process. And we currently have Thrift. We want to add Presto page to it. To efficiently execute out of process functions and make the result of that function available to the eval engine. And we have this working for Java. We hope to have this working soon for C++. This gives a lot of flexibility in terms of extending the engine with, you know, functionality that you have already built in the form of libraries, especially if it is in other languages, non-Java language. So that was kind of our bigger, better, faster, more. So one final thought. I wanted to leave everyone with this, like, do we have too much? And should we kind of look at less is more. So today we have multiple engines. We have Spark, Presto, multiple dialects, Presto SQL, HQL, very different modes. And each of these modes have like a vertical stack where they don't reuse anything. Like even at Facebook, the streaming and the batch and the interactive and the graph are almost completely different code bases, right? They don't share the eval, they don't share the language, they don't share the underlying IO libraries, and so on and so forth. They don't share the shuffle in some cases, for example. Multiple metastores. Facebook has high metastore. We have enhanced it a lot. So it's like high metastore plus, 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 plus. In open source, we have Iceberg, Delta. A lot of people are migrating from high metastore to Hive and like high metastore to Iceberg. We have many different formats. Orc and Parquet are common. Like Alibaba has its own internal format. Snowflake has its own internal format. We probably don't want to get into those kind of walled garden, right? Google, like BigQuery, has its own format, Capacitor. And then there is ML, right? We have a lot of people who are using PyTorch and TensorFlow, and these ML pipelines also need feature engineering. They also want, you know, to dynamically transform the data as it goes up into the training stack, right? So what are our opportunities here? And I feel there are a lot of opportunities for convergence. Like Presto and Spark is a good example of convergence on the language front. Velox is a good example of convergence in the, you know, eval front, right? Can we converge on Metastore, for example? Can we converge on file formats? Are Orc and Parquet really that different? If we put our, you know, minds together and created a really, really good format, maybe take either Orc or Parquet and extend that so that it covers all of our needs. Do we need multiple formats? Because it generates a lot of additional work. Like the ARIA project did a lot of work optimizing for Orc, but none of that benefits goes to Parquet. Right? Similarly, on the Metastore, I feel in order to create a truly competing open source ecosystem, by competing, I mean competing with the closed counterparts like BigQuery and Snowflake, we really need to think about this as a holistic unit, right? Where we have Presto and Spark and Hive Metastore and Orc and HDFS and all this kind of object stores, and think about how we reach a global optima, a global maxima. And this requires us probably to converge at least on the API front, on the language front, if not on the implementation front, but ideally on the implementation front as well, so that we can pool our resources and build the next best thing together. And that's all I have. Thank you. Any questions? Feel free to hop into the session. Okay. Aditi is here.
Great
okay.
Session, Bishwa. That was pretty phenomenal. The vision is exciting. And what a great way to end the day here at PrestoCon. Folks, if you have any last questions, please bring them up. I think there were many that you answered along the way. There were questions of the native worker. There were questions on the resilience and the fault tolerance of it for Spark, things like that. So a lot of things that are answered along the way. So thank you so much for a great way to end PrestoCon. Folks, that's what we have next up is the fun side of it. So we're going to do trivia, not about Presto. the trivia is going to be general trivia, and there's a prize, I think, at the end for an Amazon gift card. So we're going to jump into another session room. DJ Kara is going to be spinning for us for a little bit. Hang in there. Have fun. I hope you've enjoyed the day. It's been fun, exciting, educational for me putting together this program for everyone. And we hope to see you again in 6 months at PrestoCon in September. So with that, it's a wrap, folks. Take care. Bye-bye. Have a great evening.